All right, welcome everyone to the Fairfield Public Schools High School choir presentation of Music of the Movements Then and Now. Thank you so much for joining us this evening. I'm Lauren Pine and the choral director at Ludlowe High School.
And I'm Lauren Verney Fink, the choral director at Fairfield Warde High School.
And together with the help of all of our students, we will be hosting this evening's virtual and interactive choral presentation. In Music of the Movements Then and Now, we will be exploring and comparing protest songs from the civil rights movement to today. We are very excited to share with you our many findings as we dove deep into our unit of study this year. For this concert, we have pre-recorded 8 different tunes, all with very distinct recording strategies. We will also be sharing our historical research, as well as our interpretations through live speeches from some of our students. You will see that despite the many challenges that we faced this year, we were able to overcome our inability to have a live concert. Each tune shows a creative way in which we recorded and utilized our own students, alumni, local engineers, and community to help us with this production. This evening is very much a team effort. We please ask that you keep your cameras on and applaud between each recording. We will provide the full program that you see here and the list of resources at the end of this presentation. And additionally, we will post a recording of this Zoom call for any family and friends who may have missed the opportunity to in fact join us live.
Before we begin, given the uniqueness of tonight's presentation, I think it's important to provide a little background about how this unit of study came to be. With all of the unknowns of this school year related to COVID, the multiple learning models we taught and our students learned in, canceled concerts and physical singing restrictions, we decided to take a different approach with our music learning for the second half of the school year. A silver lining of this is that it gave us an opportunity to deeply delve into and explore music in a way that we normally would not have had. Last summer, as I watched videos of rallies and protests from all around the country and heard song after song sung in the crowds, I thought up the idea of my students and I processing the world around us through the lens of protest music. What songs are being written today that resonate with others? What old songs are resurfacing? What is the motivation behind the creation of these tunes and the singing of these messages? In order to answer these questions, I realized that we needed to look historically at protest songs over the decades. And thus the idea of learning about protest music from the civil rights movement and comparing it to music of today was born. Additionally, a big instructional focus this school year at both of our schools has been our students' social and emotional well-being and learning. This protest music unit aligns with those goals, especially in regard to social awareness strategies in order to promote a safe, supportive, and responsive learning environment. And of course, they support Fairfield Public Schools' social and civic expectations, including mutual respect, developing independence, kindness and compassion, and celebrating diversity. It's important to state that we approach this unit with great humility and care. Our intention is to honor and respect those who wrote these songs or made them prominent songs of the movements. We sought to help our students process our world in a way that is grounded in historical learning, respect for others' opinions and experiences, and self-reflection, and promotes further inquiry and problem solving. We aim to create culturally relevant performances rooted in knowledge and respect.
The first task we faced and what we must share with our audience to fully understand our program is to define protest music. What is protest music? Well, by definition, it is the use of music as an instrument for advocacy and change. We then came up with a series of guiding questions that we asked ourselves with every song that we learned and with every event that we researched. What was the prominent protest music during the civil rights movement? What was the relationship between music and the events in society? Why might music such as protest songs be created during times of unrest? What protest music is being written today? And have the protest songs of today compared to the protest songs of the civil rights movement changed? Why or why not? We began making connections between history, music, and humanity through a series of group projects, meetings with guest lecturers, and self-reflections. This evening, as we progress through our protest music historical timeline, students will share their answers to these questions in person. And first, let's start with this, the history of the civil rights movement.
The civil rights movement was a movement for social justice that took place mainly in the 1950s and 1960s. The movement was formed so that Black Americans could gain equal rights under the law. Throughout the civil rights movement, many important protests and gatherings took place, including the Montgomery bus boycott, the Woolworth's lunch counter protest, and the March on Washington. Those were only a few of the many protests that took place throughout the civil rights movement. Now, the civil rights movement wasn't all good. There were many obstacles that people had to overcome. On March 7, 1965, a day known as Bloody Sunday, the Selma to Montgomery march took a very violent turn. Many protesters were beaten and tear gassed by police, sending dozens to the hospital. Protesters didn't retaliate with violence, however, as Martin Luther King Jr. pushed for fully nonviolent protests. In the pictures at the bottom of the screen, the first picture shows that Rosa Parks refusing to give up her seat in the front of a bus for a white man. The second picture shows one of the sit-ins at Woolworth's lunch counter where four African-American students refused to leave after being denied service. And the third picture shows the March on Washington where hundreds of thousands of people gathered in front of the Lincoln Memorial.
By 1964, the Civil Rights Act was passed, guaranteeing equal employment for all and prohibiting discrimination based on race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. In 1965, the Voting Rights Act was passed, outlawing discriminatory voting practices, including literacy tests. The final act was passed during the Civil Rights era, the Fair Housing Act of 1968. Preventing housing discrimination based on race, religion, sex, and national origin. It was all because of the tremendous efforts of the civil rights activists and numerous protests of all races that these legislations came to be. It was a very long and very hard fight for many, but music played a huge role in what kept people going. Music had a huge effect on many protests during this time, and it inspired and united people, and it was a major way of peacefully protesting.
Hi, my name is Katie Sicleri. I'm a senior at Fairfield Ludlowe High School, and I will be talking a little bit about Walk Together Children. So our rendition of the African American spiritual Walk Together Children is a concertized version, and it was arranged by Robert DeCormier, an American musical conductor, arranger, and director. This particular arrangement is constructed around the concept of a slow and unhurried walking of the slaves while they worked in the fields. And you'll hear that the strong beat feels like it's in a slow two with an emphasis on beats 1 and 3. And this protest song called for a rich, warm sound, but in contrast, it also called for the diction to be that of a distinct Southern African-American accent. There also was to be a dramatic but not energetic slide into the final chord to show that even though these slaves were singing about walking without tiring, they were extremely exhausted, though they needed to keep singing on. The song was mainly super important because during slavery, this song was just a helpful reminder to them of the freedom that was to come in either heaven or on earth, given the possibility that free states and free territories came to be. The song also keeps repeating the phrase, there's a great camp meeting in the promised land, and these camp meetings that they talk about actually are representing church meetings that they went and kind of collaborated together at, and the promised land represented these newly freed states that they hoped would come and that they could move to. And now you will hear a presentation of Walk Together Children by the Bel Canto Singers and the Chamber Choir at Fairfield Ludlowe High School and Fairfield Warde High School.
Walk together, children. Walk together, children. Walk together, children. Don't you get weary. There's a great gap meeting in the promised land. I said, walk together, children.
Don't you get weary.
Walk together, children.
Don't you get weary.
Walk together, children. Don't you get weary. There's a great gap meeting in the promised land.
Oh, walk together, children.
Don't you get weary.
Walk together, children.
Don't you get weary.
Walk together, children.
Don't you get weary. There's a great big meeting in the promised land.
Yes, please give a round of applause to our soloists as well.
You don't have to wear a mask.
All right, just need to. Okay, so again, that was performed by Katie Sicleri from Fairfield Ludlowe High School and Marissa Curdy.
Hi, I'm Grace Farrell, and I'm here with Sarah Hamilton, River Peterson, and Adrian Lopez. So we're going to be talking about the song Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Me Around. So Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Me Around is a traditional song written in the 1960s.
This powerful song dates back to slavery, but was also sung in the 1960s because of how applicable it was to what was happening with Jim Crow laws, segregation, and discrimination.
Before this song was used in the civil rights movement, it was a spiritual song called Don't You Let Nobody Turn You Around.
During the summer to Montgomery marches, many people were beaten, tear-gassed, or even whipped.
One night, a group of these marchers met at the Brown Chapel, and a quiet hum broke out. Everyone started singing, Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Me Around.
With all of the emotion and passion that they experienced from the marches.
This impactful and influential song was just what people needed to get them to keep going. It is what lifted people up off of their feet and pushed them forward, though they had been shot down hundreds of times. So now we're going to listen to Ain't Gonna Let Nobody Turn Me Around by both Warde and Ludlowe Treble and Concert Choirs.
Again, a round of applause to our soloists, Isabel Thomas, Sarah Rose Genovese, Kira Nierman, and Paloma Cortez.
Hello, my name is Holly Smythe, and I'm a sophomore at Fairfield Ludlowe High School, and I'm going to be talking to you guys a little bit about the song I've Been Buked by Mahalia Jackson. Mahalia Jackson lived from 1911 to 1972, She was known as the Queen of Gospel, and she used her gospel influence in order to get her music out there, and she used her religious influence in order to also make protest music. She worked alongside Martin Luther King Jr., and she followed him as he delivered his speeches. I've Been Buked by Mahalia Jackson became one of the most famous and well-regarded songs to come out of the civil rights era. The tune runs for about 6 minutes, and initially it stemmed from a very simple melody, but Mahalia Jackson used her own runs and improvisation and made it her own. And that is the version that is being performed at the March of Washington. This performance was seen by about 250,000 protesters on August 8th, 1963. The title, I've Been Buked, speaks to the hatred and discrimination endured by the African American community. The word buked meaning disapproved, hated, and persecuted. This tune is also known as I've Been Scorned. And the version that we are going to be seeing is performed by Emma Portnay, who is a student at Fairfield Board High School.
I've been buked and I've been scorned. Oh, I've been buked and I've been scorned. Children, I've been buked and I've been scorned. I've been talked about, shows you born. There is trouble all over this world. Yes, there is trouble all over this world. Children, there is trouble all over this world. There is trouble all over this world. Ain't gonna let my religion down. Oh, ain't gonna let my religion down. Children, ain't gonna let my religion down. Ain't gonna let my religion down. I've been buked and I've been scorned. Oh, I've been buked and I've been scorned. Children, I've been buked and I've been scorned. Been talked about shows you born. I've been buked.
Again, our congratulations to senior Emma Portnoy. Thank you for this great rendition of I've Been Buked.
Hi, my name is Samantha Fahey. I'm a senior at Fairfield Warde, and I'm in the Bel Canto Singers, and I'm going to explain a little bit about who Sam Cooke was. So Sam Cooke was born January 22nd, 1931 in Clarksdale, Mississippi, and died December 11th, 1964 in Los Angeles, California. He was an American singer, songwriter, producer, and entrepreneur. Through his work and goal of bringing gospel music to the interracial market, he became a significant figure in the history of popular music and one of the most influential Black vocalists of the post-World War II period.
Hi, I'm Hazel Foley. I'm a junior at Warde and Bel Canto Singers, and I'm just going to pick up where Samantha left off. Sam Cooke began writing The Change Is Gonna Come in 1963, and the final composition was released in December of 1964, following his premature death. He created the piece as a protest song to support the civil rights movement as Black Americans fought for equality. Cooke was inspired by Bob Dylan's Blowin' in the Wind and looked to write something similar to reflect the struggles he personally faced as a person of color from the South, as well as reflect his hopes for the future. It is said that the specific intentions for the song derive from an experience he dealt with in October of 1963, when he was arrested and went to jail after refusing to be turned away from a hotel, which had previously accepted his reservation. Experience faced such as this are what inspired him to create A Change Is Gonna Come. Through research in class and observations, it has become apparent that music often acts as a catalyst for cultural expression. When people are negatively impacted by societal events, they can turn to music to find a sense of hope and expression, as well as the ability to connect with others fighting for the same cause through song. The lyrics within Sam Cooke's A Change Is Gonna Come describe his ideas and experiences and turn them into call for a change through hope. The piece goes, "It's been a long time coming, but I know a change is gonna come." A version of this song will now be shared with you, performed by Ludlowe Senior Justin Doe.
I was born by the river in a little tent. Oh, and just like the river, I've been running ever since. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh yes it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die, 'cause I don't know what's up there. beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. When I go to the movies and I go downtown, somebody keeps telling me, don't hang around. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Then I go to my brother. I'll say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me. He winds up knocking me down on my knees. There have been times that I thought I couldn't last for long, but now I think I'm able to carry on. It's been a long time coming, but I know change gonna come. Oh yes, it will.
Both vocals and video editing done by Ludlowe Senior Justin Doe.
Hi, I'm Amanda Sabato, and with me is Jillian Applebaum and Sophia Delgadio, and we are going to be talking a little bit about the song We Shall Overcome. We Shall Overcome originated from 1945 to 1946 as a response to a labor strike against American tobacco. The strike called for the African-American woman that worked in the industry to get a pay raise of 30 cents an hour. The song lifted everyone's spirits and encouraged the protesters to continue to fight for what they deserved.
The song quickly gained popularity through its simple rhythms and notes that anyone could pick up in the moment and sing as a group, promoting unity. One of the strikers, Lucille Simmons, took a strong liking to the song and decided to bring it to the Highlander Folk School in 1947. The original song was I Will Overcome, but Simmons thought changing it to We would further a sense of unity, and it has stayed that way ever since. Over time, the Will also changed to Shall.
Pete Seeger picked up the tune and officially released it in 1963. Ever since then, it has been adapted and improvised to fit the needs of many protests, most notably the civil rights movement. People sang the tune as they marched and carried signs reading We Shall Overcome, sharing the powerful message of overcoming oppression.
We Shall Overcome, like many other protest songs, continues to unify people in times of unrest. Protest music is often written during these times to express what typical words can't. Music creates emotion and meaning and often moves not only those singing it, but also those around. Music also gave people something they could all do together. It is easy for a large group of people to hear a tune that is fairly repetitive and pick it up.
Protest music often reflects events in society, now and throughout history. In the case of We Shall Overcome, this remains true. We Shall Overcome became especially popular during the civil rights era, and this is no coincidence. We Shall Overcome reflected the determination of the people that was so present during the civil rights era. Protesters faced a lot of disagreement from the society around them that was so deeply rooted in racism. But the message of We Shall Overcome helped individuals feel more motivated to continue to fight back against the oppression.
This still remains true today. Though the chords and rhythms may differ in protest songs through time to fit more modern styles, the same message still remains true, perseverance. Protest music is still being created with this message today. As a society, we still have a long way to go until we're able to completely eradicate racism, but the protest music that is created through the ages reminds us to keep fighting for what is right, regardless of those around us, what those around us say, and to come together as a community. Now we'll present We Shall Overcome from both the Ludlowe and Warde Choir departments.
Suddenly burst out singing, and I was filled with such delight as prisoned birds must find in freedom, winging wildly across the white orchids and dark green fields, on and on and out of sight. Everyone's voice was suddenly lifted, and beauty came like the setting sun. My heart was shaken with tears, and horror drifted away. Oh, but everyone was a bird, and the song was wordless. The singing will never be done.
And now we jump to protest music of today. In the last year alone, we've been navigating our way through a pandemic while also witnessing and some of us participating in the emotional and physical response to events that have happened in American Black communities through rallies, protests, and the outpouring of art. Lauren Pine and I thought, instead of being bystanders as raw creation is happening around us, we should take this opportunity to explore and understand these musical responses to societal events in a meaningful way. Our hope was that maybe this exploration would promote further inquiry from our students and inspire them to take steps in their own lives to lessen the divide between people of our country. And hopefully the students have realized the power that music can have to share a message, bring people together, and inspire action. Tonight, we're going to play a brief presentation that three wonderful Ludlowe High School Youth for Equity students created, which highlights a few recently written protest songs. Then we will share a performance from each high school's a cappella group of two other current protest tunes. Thank you so much to Andrew McInnes, Youth for Equity student leader, and members Janiyah Riley and Sophia Mughal for being a part of tonight's presentation.
Hi, I'm Andrew McInnes, and I am a junior at Fairfield Ludlowe High School representing Youth for Equity.
I'm Janiyah Riley. I am a junior at Fairfield Ludlowe High School, and I'm representing Youth for Equity.
Hi, my name is Sophia Mughal. I'm a senior at Fairfield Ludlowe High School, and I'm representing Youth for Equity. And today we'll be presenting protest music written today.
So Kedron Bryant was born in 2007 in Sicily, Italy, and began singing at the age of five. He really gained attention in 2019 after singing Brand New Life, which went viral online. And he's also appeared on NBC's variety series, Little Big Shot. The song that I'll be talking about today is called I Just Wanna Live, which was written one day after the killing of George Floyd by Kedron's mother in response to seeing George Floyd call out for his mother.
I'm a young black man doing all that I can to stay. Oh, but when I look around and I see what's being done to my kind, every day I'm being hunted as prey. My people don't want no trouble. We've got enough struggle. I just wanna live. God protect.
So three phrases that I really wanted to highlight were, the first one was, I just wanna live, which is repeated many times throughout the song, and it's also the title of the song. And Kedron's voice really emphasizes the power of this phrase. And it ties in a little to the next one, I'm being hunted as prey, which refers to police brutality and cops pulling people of color over, hunting them down as if they were prey just because of the color of their skin. And the last one, pretty self-explanatory, my people don't want trouble, we've had enough struggle. It's so simple, but so powerful. It's basically the people of color have had so much struggle, they simply just don't want any trouble.
BAX is the next person that we're going to be talking about today, and kind of a little bit about him. The background of him was he didn't talk much about his family as he prefers to keep away from the media attention. He thought he was an only child because he didn't talk about his siblings. Other people thought that he was, sorry. And he spent his entire childhood in Ottawa, but he wasn't interested in rap growing up, and he rather played sports or be a basketball player. He was spoken up as a poet in many ways, especially after spending his years in college. And as we, a lot of people know him as now, a motivational speaker. And through that, he rise with his career as a rapper through motivation. The impact of the song that we're going to see in just a little bit basically was dropped just like other songs that he discussed about Black Lives Matter, and he shed light on the issues of racism. The song that's going to be playing is produced by Barbara Sauce, and this song has a powerful message of no one is born with racism, while instead society brings it upon people. And it talks about how these riots are a revolution in our time. He wrote this song for people like Sandra Bland, George Floyd, who died due to police brutality in custody.
Is what we really need. So cut me open, cut you open, rest of color, every single human being bleeds. Let's come together, cops, citizens, and in between, and rally for the rights of everybody in humanity. Black, blue, white, green, playing for the same team. I am okay, but boy, that doesn't mean I...
So there are a lot of different messages and meanings behind this song. But Black Lives Matter opens with the phrase, "I can't breathe," repeatedly showing its strength through words. He does not something that he says once, but he says it throughout, and it especially opens up with the phrase kind of opening up about his message through the song. And through the song, he asks people to raise their voice, and he says, "Don't you dare stay silent." You can see in the picture across that says, "To be silent is to be complicit." So silence shouldn't be something that's told within this song, and that's what he emphasizes. And the last part is, in one of the stanzas, he has said the word to dry tears of Black people brought on to say, "We can bring back hope, but not people that are dying." So once again, as we know, there are many dying from police brutality, and those who aren't standing up for themselves, they should stand up and raise their voice. And that's what the overall meaning of this song comes from.
The next artist we'll be highlighting is Kendrick Lamar. He was born in Compton, California in 1987, and he began releasing a series of mixtapes under the name K-Dot, which gained the attention of Dr. Dre, who became his mentor and signed Lamar to his label. In 2012, Lamar released his debut major label album entitled Good Kid, Mad City, which garnered him impressive acclaim. He followed up his successful debut with his 2015 album, To Pimp a Butterfly, and his 2017 album, Damn, both of which won Grammys in the Best Rap Album category. In 2018, Lamar won the Pulitzer Prize for his album, Damn, making him the first and only person to win a Pulitzer for a hip-hop album and the first artist to win the Pulitzer outside of the classical and jazz genres. The Pulitzer Board wrote that Lamar's Damn is a virtuosic song collection unified by its vernacular authenticity and rhythmic dynamicism that offers affecting vignettes capturing the complexity of modern African-American life. Kendrick Lamar's All Right was a single off his 2015 album, To Pimp a Butterfly. All Right was notably used in a 2015 protest against police brutality in Cleveland, Ohio, and in the following years, it has continued to be a protest anthem used in the Black Lives Matter movement. In an interview, Lamar revealed that he was inspired to write All Right after visiting South Africa and the cell on Robben Island where Nelson Mandela was imprisoned. In addition, Lamar stated in an interview that the song was influenced by the history of enslavement in the United States. It's not my time, it's to fight it up. Oh, it's my lifetime. Hard times like y'all, bad trips like y'all. Nazareth, I'm on one, homie, you on one. But if God got us, then we gon' be all right. 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 So some significant lyrics from the song, All Right. The opening lyric.
All's my life I has to fight.
Is a reference to The Color Purple by Alice Walker. Another lyric, quote, what you want, you, a house, you a car, 40 acres and a mule, a piano, a guitar. 40 acres and a mule refers to the promise made to former slaves after the Civil War that they would receive 40 acres and a mule as reparations. This plan issued via General William T. Sherman's Special Field Order No. 15 was eventually overturned later that year by President Lincoln's successor, Andrew Johnson. This lyric in All Right is wrapped from the perspective of Lucy, which is a shortened form of Lucifer. And in Wellesley's theory, an earlier track on To Pimp a Butterfly, a nearly identical lyric is wrapped from the perspective of Uncle Sam, demonstrating the deceptive nature of American systems and institutions, especially for people of color, and likening this treatment to the devil's deceit. Another lyric, also the namesake of this song,
but we gon' be all right,
is a common refrain throughout the song, which gives a message of hope. Thank you.
And I do believe we have our members of Youth from Equity. I saw Andrew and Sophia, if you would unmute yourselves and just say a quick hello so we can say thank you. And Janiyah, if you're here.
Hello.
Thank you. Thank you so much for your presentation, for all the research, and for joining us this evening. Thank you so much for all the hard work that you do with Youth for Equity. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Andrew McInnes, and I am a junior.
I'm not having luck with us today. There we go.
Hi, my name is Isabel Toma. I'm a sophomore at Fairfield Ludlow High School, and I'm in Treble Choir, and I'm going to be talking about Preach. So this song was sparked by John Legend's frustration at current injustices, and in the video and lyrics, you can see that John is overwhelmed with emotion. It's centered around social justice and racism, specifically police brutality, gun violence being shown at the school shooting, and violence relating to immigration, such as border separation and deportation. He has an internal battle as to whether he should do something to create change or just let conditions continue as they are. In his words, do we become apathetic or do we become engaged? He decides that he can't just acknowledge how terrible these issues are without doing anything or preach, making the song a call to action. These are exemplified by the lyrics. I just can't sit and hope. I can't just sit and pray that I can find the love when all I see is pain. He grew up in the church and wants to exemplify the values that they were taught, especially love thy neighbor through real action. Due to his personal beliefs, he thinks that we should be more like Jesus, who was a revolutionary and spoke up for the underdog, and believes it is more important to listen to what Jesus actually said and create change based on that, rather than just talk or preach about it. The hashtag Can't Just Preach allows people to share their stories and raise awareness about issues like these. He also created Free America, an initiative to change the American justice system by supporting those impacted by the criminal justice system and those who are also trying to change it. He says that change in this area will be created by challenging stereotypes, breaking down barriers, uplifting solutions to help end mass incarceration and invest in just, equitable, and thriving communities across the United States. He has a goal to raise $50,000 with Preach. And now the Fairfield Ludlow a cappella will perform Preach with solos by Emerson Lyons, Katie Sicleri, and Kyle Garriott.
Just to clear out.
So I must thank my students for help with this project. We had the equipment of Justin Doe. We had audio engineering by Gavin Schlinghide. Our video was made by Kyle Garyak, so very much a student team. And then of course our soloists, Emerson Lyons, Katie Sicleri, and Kyle Garyak.
I'm Meg, a senior from Warde. I'm in the Bel Canto Singers, Chamber Choir, and the acapella group, and I'll be talking about Rise Up by Andre Day. Andre Day's inspiring song, Rise Up, is now a staple piece that has been adopted into the Black Lives Matter movement, but she didn't write it for that exact intent. In an interview with CNN, she said that the song really started as a prayer for her to God, asking for something to motivate her to keep going. Around that time, she had been experiencing a lot of personal troubles. Her friend had been just diagnosed with cancer, and she needed a sign from God to keep going. Due to its inspiring nature, she performed the song at the 2016 Democratic Convention and performed on stage after the families of Trayvon Martin and Sandra Bland spoke on stage showing their support for Hillary Clinton. Trayvon was fatally shot as a 17-year-old, and Sandra was arrested for not using a turn signal in her car and was found hanging herself. Her death was ruled a suicide, but sparked the Say Her Name movement. Later in that same CNN interview, she said that she got to speak with the families backstage and wept with them, saying, "I was sad for their loss, but I was also inspired. They were still here. They were lifting their voices. They understood that their purpose for being there was bigger than just them and just their pain. They were speaking to everyone's pain." Day acknowledged that her song had been adopted by the Black Lives Matter movement and said that she was honored to have that much of an impact. She said that her song's influence reminded her of two things: the power of her platform and her duty as an artist to keep creating music that promotes positive change, and that we still have a lot of work to do as a country and that we need to keep the motivation coming. Here is Rise Up, performed by Warde Acapella, featuring our soloist, Paige Sobel.
Find the fighter, but I see it in you, so we gotta walk. Congrats, Paige Sokol, on your beautiful solo. And thank you to Bobby Master for your audio editing. And that arrangement was by our Warde alumni, Benjamin Sullivan.
So as you have heard in each live presentation, we have been answering the guiding questions, such as what is the relationship between music and events in society, as well as why might music such as protest songs be created during times of unrest? The answer to the question, what was the prominent protest music during the civil rights movement, is answered in our song selections. Now we will have students reflect on our final guiding questions. Have the protest songs of today compared to the songs of the civil rights movement changed? Why or why not? Not surprisingly, our students have shared very similar answers.
Have the protest songs of today compared to the songs of the civil rights movement changed? Why or why not? Personally, I don't particularly think that they have changed that much because of the fact that it's really this same message that has continued to have to be played out time and time again. We're seeing common themes from the civil rights movement in today, and whether it's policing, whether it's implicit biases in society, whether it's economic freedoms, it's really similar sort of topics that are being overviewed today. And for that reason, I don't really think the music has changed, because it continues to relay the message that we're not backing down, we're not stopping until we get what we deserve. So I don't think music has really changed in that respect.
Most songs from the civil rights movement were really spiritual and religious, and they had uplifting messages that were presented at a slower pace. A lot of the lyrics had more metaphorical messages, whereas if you take a look at protest music today, the lyrics are very, very direct, and the music is very loud and very strong standing. And I think the reason for that is because, you know, people of color are so tired of dealing with discrimination and these implicit biases, and they're not afraid to speak out anymore. Music from both time periods do have the same overall message, in the sense that we'll overcome, we need to keep fighting and persisting. But regardless, you know, music is a great way to let out all of those emotions, and they leave such powerful messages behind.
Have the protest songs of today compared to the songs of the civil rights movement changed? Why or why not? Protest music today hasn't so much changed from the music of the civil rights movement as much as it has evolved from that era. The underlying basis from which the music has been created, the motivation and the drive to find freedom and equality, remains constant throughout both the civil rights movement and today. But the direct causes of the music are slightly different, as are the mediums through which the music is created. Contemporary genres of music carry a different tonality and different voice for modern protest songs, but the message remains entirely the same. The fight for racial freedom and equality in the United States continues, and this genre of music will continue not to change, but to evolve, as more causes are found and more genres are developed, until the end goal is finally achieved.
So everyone, don't go anywhere. We have one more tune to play you, and it's our big finale closer. So don't go anywhere. You will be thankful you stayed to listen to our last song. But before we do that, we just want to pause a moment and thank the many, many individuals who helped make this presentation possible. This was months in the making and so much work behind the scenes, and we are so thankful for so many people, starting with the other choral directors of Warde a cappella, Sarah Hofer and Amanda Villalone. And as many of you know, I'm actually on maternity leave right now, but I came out of my newborn mom sleep-deprived stupor this evening for this presentation. So a huge thank you to my long-term substitute teacher, Will Mandelbaum. Thank you to our audio and audio video production team. there was so much work that went in behind the scenes to put these together. Connor Frawley, Scott Haskett, Ivanovich, and Matt Cooney, as well as students, Justin Doe, Kyle Gariak, Bobby Master. Oh no, Gavin. Oh, I'm going to mess up your name. So thank you. Oh man, I should have practiced that. I'm so sorry, Gavin. Coleman Connolly and Andrew Fuller. Thank you to all of the students for helping us put this together as well. And I think we have a list of our student presenters. Yes. Sorry, Lauren, I think I just stepped on your toes. Go ahead.
No worries whatsoever. So from Ludlowe, our student presenters this evening included Jillian Applebaum, Sophia Delgadio, Madden DeSabato, Katie Sicleri, Holly Smythe, and Isabel Toma.
And from Warde, Megan Andrade, Grace Farrell, Samantha Fahey, Hazel Foley, Chloe Graham, Abigail Jacobs, Charlotte Lovell, and I'm realizing we missed Adrian Lopez, River Peterson, and Sarah Hamilton. I'm so sorry, I didn't realize all four of you were presenting that slide, which was awesome.
Many other thanks. We have our Ludlowe principal, Greg Hatzis, our Warde principal, Paul Kavanaugh. Our house principal at Ludlowe is Sean Colley, and the house principal at Warde, Brian Keating. Our music curriculum coordinator, who's here this evening, thank you, Dan Bechtow, for joining us. A music secretary, Kathy Gabriel, I also saw join us. The Music Parents Association. We had two brilliant guest lecturers, Dr. Deborah Simmons and Gavin Staten, visit our students. Renee Simpson, Brian Torf, the FEA Anti-Racism Committee, especially John Whaley for your support. Voices for Equity, especially students, Sarah Rose Genovese. Youth for Equity, the leader, Andrew McInnes, and Sophia Mughal and Janiyah Riley, again, for your presentation and your support. Our accompanists, Juan Wang and Olivia Beniston, Mike Ferenz and the Warde custodial staff, Scott Marsland, Mark Fratterelli, Charles Flynn. Our student designers of the slideshow and program include Sylvie Cimino, Caitlin May, and Anna Pasilio. And of course, everyone who submitted the many recordings, but especially for our final tune. We will share this list with you in a program that we will share at the end of the evening. So we have, you can see the full roster of both high schools. So we do thank our students for their dedication to the music and the cause. Our program boasts over 200 students. And again, their names can be found here, and we will be sharing them publicly with a program very shortly. So as we were brainstorming with the students on words that came to mind when we're trying to problem solve the injustices and inequities of the world around us, there was a common theme. Solidarity, unity, peace, community, respect, equality. So we wanted to conclude our concert with a song that would demonstrate these characteristics. We also wanted to reach out beyond our choral students and to get to the greater community involved, both in joining us in a virtual community choir, but more importantly, to help us carry out our message. After all, what could be more unifying than coming together in song? In our final tune, we gathered over 150 singers from around the county. We hope you can spot a few officials, staff members, former music teachers, and even children of the staff amongst the participants. This is performed by Bel Canto Chamber Choir, Treble Choir, Concert Choir, and the greater community. And while the lyrics may, from a popular 80s tune, might ring on the side of cheesy or even cliche, there is a powerful message to behold. Our work here is not done. We are just beginning. But if we work on this together and share our message with others, well then, it's true. We make a better place, just you and me.
people dying, and it's time to lend a hand to life, the greatest gift of all.
We can't go on pretending day by day that someone somehow will soon make a change.
We are all a part of one great big family, and the truth, you know, love is all we need.
We are the world, we are the children, we are the ones to make a brighter day, so let's start giving. There's a choice we're making, we're saving.
So many people to thank. Again, our soloists, Natalia Godo, Coleman Connolly, Mr. Hatzis, Mr. Kavanaugh, Miss Leon, and Miss Ramam Kyandi from Warde. Of course, Ms. Scott Haskett, who I believe is watching us this evening. He was our incredible engineer who put all this together. We have our first select woman. We have Mr. Cummings, our superintendent. Just everybody really chipped in and made this really incredible performance. And I hope you caught, again, some of your former teachers in the music world as well. So thank you all. This was truly an incredibly moving interpretation of a tune that we all know so well. And we hope that you were equally moved by the music and by our presentation this evening. So as we mentioned, we will be sharing both a program and a recording of this entire Zoom call. We will post them on Google Classroom per usual, but we will also post them on each high school's respective YouTube channel. So each music department has a YouTube channel, and students again will receive the link directly. So please feel free to share the concert, share your message, and share that with family and friends as we depart in just a moment.
Thank you again, everyone, for joining us this evening and for your reception to our program. We've also put together a brief list of resources for you to check out if you feel so inclined. And we will put a bunch of links in the chat for you. So before you hang up the call, be sure to copy and paste those links. And we just hope tonight's presentation has inspired you to answer our guiding questions and let those answers lead you to ask more questions and seek solutions both within your day-to-day life and beyond. Now let's all take a moment to recognize all of our student soloists, presenters, and performers one more time. If we could all unmute, turn our cameras on, and give them a big final round of applause. Congratulations. Again, we just
if you can wait 20 seconds, I'll put those links in the chat. There we go. There are the links. Again, they will be available very shortly, and we will post our Zoom call. Again, thank you everyone for being in attendance this evening. Thank you for sharing our message. Thank you, students, for all your hard work. It's been a lot of work, but I hope it was well worth it. Thank you so much.